This morning, our speaker is Peter Sanders from the University of Karlsruhe. He's here to tell us about lots of different interesting work that his group has been doing on fast route planning. So,
thank you, Ami. I'm very happy that I can be here today. This nice environment. So what I explained to you has been done together with lots of co-authors. The names you see here are my current group, except I put Dominik Schultes in brackets because unfortunately he left to industry unrelated to route planning. But he is one of the people who was on this Google Research Award proposal, which is one of the reasons I'm here today. So I wanted to mention him, and he did a lot of the initial work on this also. So what is route planning? I probably don't have to tell you. You want to find shortest path in large road networks. Maybe also other kinds of networks. Recently, we want them to be time dependent also. Meaning that the travel time along a net in the network depends on the time of day. What do we want? Of course, queries should be fast. There are actually point-to-point queries and many-to-many queries. I will tell you a little bit more about that. We can do some pre-processing, but it should be fast and it shouldn't take too much space. And maybe pre-processing is a problem because networks change, so we want to be able to do fast updates also. Applications are route planning systems in the internet, which probably on the short-term basis is what's most interesting for Google. But also car navigation systems, you all know that. And other applications like logistic optimizations, traffic simulation. And we have a particular application on ride sharing that I will talk about a little bit. So this is the most difficult slide. It explains our most recent technique in a single slide. Don't worry, there are a few more slides coming. But maybe it's interesting to spend a few minutes on it because it's actually very simple. So suppose we have somehow ordered the nodes of our network by importance. Least important first, 1 to n. Now the idea is to build a hierarchy that has one level for each node. And building a new level basically means getting rid of one node, the least important remaining node. So here you see an example. We want to get rid of node V. So what do we have to do? I mean, we can't simply delete it because then the remaining graph doesn't have all the shortest paths it had before. But what we can do is we add shortcut edges. That's the red ones, the red edges with weight 2 here, where this red edge basically encodes this shortcut, this path of length 2 that goes through V, and this red edge encodes, I don't know whether that works with the camera. Which encodes this shortest path, and you can may also notice that from the yellow node to the green node at the bottom, we do not need a red edge because there's another shortest path that doesn't need V. Right? And that's important because we want to keep this graph sparse. Okay. And what we get from this is what we call a contraction hierarchy. That's on the in the picture on the bottom. Where edges are all only followed upwards when you do a query. So when you do a query from S to T, you just look at the edges upwards, and you find this red path, which now contains a shortcut from node 6 to node 4, which you can unpack by just some simple recursive data structures. So that's the basic idea about contraction hierarchies. So In a nutshell, by this contraction process, we are transforming the graph to a graph that contains shortcuts, and we are directing these edges always upwards, so that both a query is a bidirectional search in this directed acyclic graph. And you only follow the edges to the more important nodes. And then, as usual in bidirectional search, the search frontiers will eventually meet, and the best meeting point is the shortest path. Okay. So, how do we order the nodes? What we use in the basic case is a priority queue, where the priority of a node is weighted with a couple of terms, and in front of each term we have a tuning parameter that helps us to get a good ordering. And what are these terms? The most important one is what we call the edge difference. It counts the shortcuts we have to insert for the contraction minus the number of edges that were there before. So in this example, we get rid of three edges and introduce two shortcuts, so the edge difference is minus one. And we want to have small edge differences because that means that the graph is sparse. Another important ingredient is what we call uniformity terms that make sure that the graph is contracted uniformly everywhere in the graph. And that will mean that we get a reasonably flat hierarchy. And there are very easy ways to get this, for example, by just counting the number of neighbors of a node that have already been deleted. And then the construction process simply takes the smallest priority node, puts it into the next level of the hierarchy, contracts it, updates the priority terms of the neighbors, and repeats. So here's an example. That's a route from Saarbrücken to Karlsruhe. Hannah will like that because she was working here, the Max Planck Institute for Computer Science, as I did for 7 years. And you want to go to Karlsruhe, that's a medium range thing, like 140 kilometers. And we see we have a path of 299 edges in the original network, which is compressed to just 13 shortcuts. And if you have routes on a continental scale in Europe, you will have something like 20 shortcuts. So it's a very effective way of compressing paths also. And what do you think is the path given by Google? So that's this one, which is a bit strange. I wrote you an email about it, and you said, yeah, it's strange, we will change the objective function, but it didn't happen apparently. So the point with this path is it takes a motorway all the time, and it's like 40 kilometers longer distance, and it takes about the same time in the Google evaluation function. In practice, it takes longer because of the trend. Anyway, so it's an interesting example where it won't do to have hierarchies that just follow the street categories, right? Because this one is not a motorway. Okay. So this is the search space. So the red edges are the search space from Saarbrücken, the blue edges are the edges from Karlsruhe. It looks pretty big, right? This is the channel to Britain. So we go very far away, but it's not a problem because if you look at the dots here on the picture, that's the nodes we expand. And for example, this complicated thing is just a single edge, which can be relaxed in a couple of nanoseconds. We have all in all 316 settled nodes and 951 relaxed edges. And an ordinary Dijkstra search would have looked at probably a million nodes. So it's a huge speed up. It's like 100 microsecond query time, or probably less because it's a short distance query, maybe 50 microseconds on an ordinary PC. By the way, if there are questions, don't hesitate to ask them. So what do we have with contraction hierarchy? It's the foundation of all our other methods right now. They're conceptually very simple. It's just this contraction process, right? In previous works of highway hierarchies, we had two different things. One of them was basically simplified form of contraction, and the other one was a more sophisticated thing that gets rid of edges. We don't do that anymore, apparently for road networks, it's not necessary. Pre-processing time for our standard benchmark with about 19 million nodes is 7.5 minutes pre-processing. That includes actually the node ordering. In many cases, you don't have to do it. In that case, it's like less than 2 minutes pre-processing. This says 200 microseconds to determine the path length, but there are also variants that take only 100, I don't know. And about half a millisecond to unpack the path, which, by the way, is about the same time you need to just traverse the path. And space consumption is interesting. It says 23 bytes per node, but that's actually less than what you need to just store the graph if you want to implement Dijkstra's basic algorithm on it. Because the thing is, for Dijkstra's algorithm, you need to store undirected edges in both directions because you don't know from which side you will enter them. Whereas in our technique, you only store them in the direction unimportant node to important node. So you have additional space because you need shortcuts, but then you save space because you store edges only once. And the bottom line is actually positive. But that may be not so important for Google. It's not a lot of space anyway. Our faster technique is yet another two orders of magnitude faster, where we are basically able to reduce route planning to just lots of table lookups, or actually like 100 table lookups. The idea you see in this picture here, basically for every node we store access node, something if you want to go from the Google office in Seattle to anywhere in the US that's sufficiently far away, there's probably only I guess here there's only one place, right? You go to Interstate 5, and then either you go to the 95 to go east, or you go south on the Interstate 5, and that's it, right? So there's only one or two places that you have to remember. And if you want to go to Canada, there might be another access to a motorway. That's it. And it's similar in almost everywhere else. So you just remember these places where you access a long-distance network, you remember how far they are away, and then you have just try all combinations. And the shortest one is your shortest path. So that interestingly got us a publication in Science, which usually doesn't publish computer science results. And even the press was interested. Like Scientific American said, oh, it's one of the 50 most interesting results of the year 2007. Another thing that's yet an order of magnitude faster is computing distance tables, which you need in logistics optimizations, for example. For example, a 10,000 times 10,000 table filling, it takes like 10 seconds. That's 0.1 microsecond for each distance computation. And that's interesting for quite a number of applications, and actually we have one that might even be interesting for Google also, ride-sharing. In Germany, it's actually a very popular thing for people who don't earn a lot of money, like students and so on. But I think it gets also more and more interesting for people who want to share cars when they go to work, because they have long commuting distances and want to save on fuel. The websites I know currently basically work like an ordinary database, right? You tell start and destination, And then it looks in the database if there's an offer in the database that has the same start and destination. And some of them have the ability to search in a circle. But suppose you go from Seattle to San Diego, right? And somebody else wants to go from San Francisco to Los Angeles. Then you can give him a ride, and it's on the way, more or less. And you wouldn't find that in a circular search or anything like that. So this doesn't exploit all the possibilities. And actually, it's not so important between the big cities. But if you have something in the countryside, and Germany, for example, is a country where there are people living almost everywhere, right? And there, it's sometimes not easy to find these rideshare opportunities because they're only between the big cities. Mm. And what you have to do for this, the database is currently at something like 100,000 entries. If you want to do something more clever, like looking at how much of a detour would the driver have to take to give the other one a ride. That's a good measure of how expensive it is to meet somehow, right? Then you have to basically compute two shortest path distances to figure that out. For each entry in the database, so one search in the database is 200,000 shortest path computations. That's prohibitive, right? No, not for us. We do it in 25 milliseconds, basically using this technique. Okay. And of course, once we have a million offers or so, we might do some geometric preprocessing to further speed it up. But currently, it's really not needed. So that's kind of a nice demonstration of the power of play. And I think it's a useful application. Usually our measurements are without taking penalties for taking turns into account. We have done experiments with this. It considerably increases memory and query time and so on, but it's still very good. I mean, with contraction hierarchies, it's 420 microseconds, which is still more than fast enough for most applications. And we even have done some experiments how to do it with very little space and so on, which would be needed for mobile navigation systems. Now let's look at dynamic scenarios, which is maybe also interesting for Google. What's an important application is in the radio or some digital format that's available like TMC and TMC Pro and others, you get information about traffic jams. Not a very big number right now, but important because it's usually on highways. And that changes your cost function, and that, on the first glance, destroys all the pre-processing efforts. But we have developed techniques where you can handle at least the number of edge weights that changes that are currently usual. And there are actually two scenarios, one in a server. What you would probably do, you would update your pre-processed data structure, but only at those places where something changes. And for a mobile implementation, you do something else. You keep the pre-processed data as it is, but you change the query algorithm so that you still get optimal paths. So what we currently have is we have actually two papers on this dynamic scenario, but I will tell you the mobile implementation, which is on the Nokia N800. It has a 400 megahertz ARM processor. We are able to compress the graph representation by about a factor of 3 compared to the straightforward internal memory compression. Queries take something like 56 milliseconds. And what's even more important, perhaps, is when you miss a turn or something like that, then you have to recompute your path. Then things are still already in the cache that are very useful, then it takes only 14 milliseconds. So what we have is instantaneous routing on a mobile device. And for this, we have also implemented this dynamization techniques. And with 1,000 edge rate changes, which is already a pretty big number, It's still well below a second. Yes. So our newest result, which was presented on the Alenex conference in January, is extension of contraction hierarchies to time-dependent route planning. And what we do there concretely is we assume that we are optimizing travel time. We assume that the travel time function of an edge is piecewise linear. I mean, you can approximate almost anything with this, right? And we need the so-called FIFO property, which means that the function cannot go down with a slope of more than one with time, which means basically that it never pays to wait at the beginning of an edge until you enter it, which is reasonable for whole networks, I think. You do need these assumptions. I mean, you don't necessarily want to optimize travel time, right? But if you want to have optimal paths and want to use things like Dijkstra's algorithm, then you better have this thing, because otherwise it becomes NP-hard to solve these problems. Doesn't mean that you can't do it in practice. And of course, that will be one topic for future work. But we wanted to start with keeping things thin. So what we are solving is the so-called earliest arrival problem, where a query means we have given a starting node, a destination node, and the departure time, and we are looking for a path that minimizes arrival time. Okay. So that's two layers of building blocks that we need here. First layer is, what do we do with these edge rate functions? Basically, three operations. We have to evaluate it, and that's an important operation during query that takes basically constant time. So it's interesting, when you implement time-dependent Dijkstra's algorithm, it runs almost as fast as a static one, because evaluating this edge rate function is not really the limiting factor here. You have priority queue operations, you have cache faults for accessing the graph, etc., etc. And maybe it's a factor of two or less. And then during pre-processing, you have to do more things. You have to compute the minimum of two functions, like here. Or you have to chain two functions. So if you have two edges, G and F, described by functions G and F, then you may want to compute a function that describes the travel time that you get when you first go this edge and then that edge, that you call chaining. Both operations take linear time in the complexity of the input functions. And both have the not so nice property that the output complexity, in the worst case, is the sum of the input complexities. So when you do this, you get more and more complex functions, which is kind of bad news. So now, from this, we have three basic techniques that you can use for all kinds of time-dependent route planning techniques. One is just the time-dependent Dijkstra algorithm, which, with these FIFO property assumptions, works basically in the same way as Dijkstra's algorithm, except that when you are at a node U and relax an edge UV, the travel time you use for this edge has to be evaluated at the shortest path distance time of U, which you know in the case of Dijkstra's algorithm, so it's no problem. Then we have something else which we call profile search. Here you do basically Dijkstra's algorithm not for a particular starting time, but for all possible starting times. And then the edge labels, this was a tentative distance in Dijkstra's algorithm. Right? Now these edge labels became functions again. And an edge relaxation basically means that you have to take the minimum of the old label and the label you get when you take the shortest path description to U which is a current label of you, actually. It's not necessarily the shortest path, unfortunately. And chain it with the function describing the edge. Now, unfortunately, you cannot guarantee anymore that here you have the shortest path distance, which means you may have to reluct an edge several times. Then you get what's called a label correcting error. But in practice, you don't have to do these three relaxations very often, so it's not a big problem. What is a big problem is that usually this f old thing, I mean that's, or this thing, fu also, they describe an entire path which can contain hundreds of edges, right? So it will be a very complex function if you evaluate everything exactly. And that's not so easy. It's a very expensive operation, yes?
So in normal Dijkstra, you choose which node to settle next by its minimum cost.
Yeah.
But here you have these vector valued costs.
Yeah.
How do you, which might not have a strict minimum.
Yeah.
So how do you choose which node to settle next?
So more or less arbitrarily, we take just the minimum of this function. You could do anything. You could take the average value of this the function describing the label, whatever.
Okay.
It's just a heuristics.
But
by being willing to do these re-relaxations, you remain correct. And the number of re-relaxations you make may depend on the choice of this heuristics. But the minimum works reasonably well. Okay. So this is a very expensive operation, so you have to use it very sparingly. And that's the reason for our third component, where you do something like a compromise, which we call min-max label search. It can be viewed as an approximate version of the profile search, where we only compute upper and lower bounds for the travel time. And now a distance label is a pair, minimum, upper bound, lower bound, upper bound. And edge relaxations means that we do component-wise minima and things like that. So it's basically a Dijkstra search working on vectors of size 2. Again, we don't really know what kind of priority function we should use, so consistently with the previous heuristics, we choose the lower bound rather than the upper bound for the priority queue. We again get a label correcting algorithm, and then the minimum operation, what you see here, kind of narrows down things. Okay. Now, how to use this for making contraction hierarchies time-dependent? There are two major challenges here. First, we have to do contraction using the pre-computation, right? And I said, well, we are removing a node and we're introducing shortcuts. And we don't want to use all conceivable shortcuts. We want to prove that certain shortcuts are not necessary. For this, we need something. We need an alternative path, which we call a witness. Okay, in order to find these witnesses exactly, we would have to do profile search, which is very expensive. And if you implement this in a straightforward manner, things get incredibly slow, at least for large networks. So we have to do something more clever. And then there's another thing which. The scientists involved in route planning were always telling us, well, you are you poor guys, you have these very fast static techniques, but they are all using bidirectional search. Sorry, this won't work for time dependent. You lost. And there was a lot of work on getting fast unidirectional route planning techniques. But we said, no, we stick with bidirectional search, and it worked, which I'll explain you in a second. What's the problem here? The point is that in order to translate bidirectional search to a time-dependent setting, you would have to do a backward search from a node. You want to do a backward time-dependent Dijkstra search, right? Which is no problem if you know the arrival time. And otherwise, you can't use time-dependent Dijkstra. But the arrival time is the thing you want to compute. It's not something we know, so we are in trouble. That's a challenge. Okay, so what are we doing? First, about the profile search. What we basically do is we don't do a naive profile search. So say we have we are considering whether we need a shortcut from U to W, V or V, then we contract V. And we would have to use a pretty big search space for a forward profile search from U. Instead, what we do is we do a min-max label search from U and use the bounds and the data we get there to identify something that we call a corridor that defines kind of the edges that are interesting candidates for witnesses. And only in this corridor we do a profile search, which is basically unpacking a path. Which is still not very cheap because we have to unpack it and compute the travel time function and then compare the results of the travel time function for the shortcut. But it's extremely much faster than this thing. Okay. And what about the bidirectional thing? Again, it's this min-max thing that we use. So for the forward search, there's no problem. We can just do the time-dependent Dijkstra. For the backward search, we could even do just an exploration of this directed acyclic graph. Even that works reasonably well. We do a little bit more cleverly by doing a min-max label search. And then at the meeting points, we have information that tells us which of the meeting points are promising. Because if we know a path, for example, we know that this path plus this upper bound is less than this path plus that lower bound, then we could drop this edge, this meeting point, right? And again, we get something like a corridor, which is interesting for, which contains, in a guaranteed way, all the shortest paths from S to T. And then, basically, we continue the forward search in this corridor, starting from the meeting points and using only the edges that have been marked by the backward search, which funnels it into the target. And that works fairly well. So here are some experiments. So we have a time-dependent network of Germany with quite realistic travel time functions that are basically at a 15-minute resolution. And of course, the midweek scenario is much more complicated than the Sunday scenario, where it's almost static. So what we have is something like 20 minutes pre-processing time, 1 millisecond query time, which is like 1200 times faster than time-dependent Dijkstra. For the Sunday scenario, interestingly, the pre-processing time is lower, but the query time doesn't profit very much. But it's still good, of course. The problem we do have is that currently it takes a lot of space. Yes.
Do all the nodes here have significant time variation, or are some of them fairly flat?
So about 12% of the edges are time dependent. But as I said, this is probably quite realistic because residential streets and so on don't have a lot of traffic anyway. Yeah, so the problem we right now have is that the memory consumption would be too big to extend this to, say, all of Europe. Because the memory goes up and up, the edges get more and more complicated travel time functions. But there are lots of opportunities of low-level compression, which would give us a factor of 2 or 3. And you can also use approximations of the travel time functions. We've already first experiments about that, which tell us that there should also be at least a factor of 2 to 4 that we can get from that. And if you do it in the right way, you still get exact rules, actually, which is probably not so important for applications. Because the input is approximate anyway. We also have a parallel pre-computation implemented, which is relatively easy for the contraction. And I mean, I guess the node ordering you don't have to do again and again every day because the basic hierarchy of the network remains the same. And then basically, you can contract and parallel any independent set of nodes. with a couple of details you have to be careful about. Even the node ordering you can parallelize by going away from this priority queue and basically computing the priority queue priority values in a batched manner and then just picking a set of nodes that are sufficiently independent from each other. They should have a reasonably big distance from each other and have low priority. And then you get something that's very similar to the sequential approach. And we see something like 6.5 speed up on an 8-core machine. And I guess you can parallelize that on distributed memory machines with more implementation effort, but all of these are basically local searches in a huge graph. I don't see a fundamental reason why you couldn't scale it even more if you have in particular bigger networks. I mean, this is all for Germany. What we want to do is do it for Eurasia or so. Okay. So, to summarize, I hope that I made clear that static routing by now is an easy problem. We know how to do it very efficiently. There are nice applications that require a massive amount of routing, and there it's still interesting. Otherwise, we are too fast anyway. I mean, for just giving directions in Google, I guess you need something like 20 to 50 milliseconds anyway to display things and routes and have latencies and so on. So whether it takes 100 microseconds or 200 microseconds to compute a route is not really interesting. But there are applications like these logistics applications, ride sharing and so on, where you would like that. This is important. And time-dependent routing, we have also demonstrated, I think, quite clearly that you can do it on server machines, which is basically the Google application, I guess. The algorithmically interesting thing is that we can handle bidirectional time-dependent search. We have very fast queries, reasonably fast pre-computations. The only remaining problem is space consumption, but as I said, there are relatively easy ways to get around that. So maybe more interesting for you is what do we want to do in the future? What we are currently looking at is various ways to work with multiple objective functions. So there are at least two important interpretations of this. One is that you want to have the user choose certain preferences. Like, oh, I'm driving with a slow truck, and then maybe the routes would be different than if you have a sports car. Or you say, oh, I would like to have an energy efficient route. And then things change, right? And the other thing is multi-criteria, where you say, oh, well, I mean, I want to be fast, I want to be energy efficient, but also it should be an easy route, and I don't really know which one is more important for me. Then maybe it's good to have several choices given that are reasonable. And that's a classical multi-criteria optimization problem. Actually, for time-dependent travel, you probably want to have other objective functions than just travel time. And mathematically, you get something very similar to the multi-criteria thing, because now you still have to take travel time into account, because that's what defines where you have to evaluate your travel time function. And it's objective, which is then inherently already a multi-criteria problem and probably NP-hard. So that should also be addressed. And then there are other things like integrate individual transportation and public transportation. I mean, when you say, I want to go from Karlsruhe, the street where I live, to the Google office in Seattle, then this thing should tell you, well, walk to the railway station, take a train to Frankfurt Flughafen, take a direct Lufthansa connection to SeaTac Airport, then take the bus, blah, 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 right? And in particular in Europe, when you want to have cheap travel, there are dozens of airports which have strange connections, but then you can travel cheap rather than always going through Frankfurt. And currently, recently for a vacation I wanted to during June, I spent 3 or 4 hours researching all the possibilities. It would really be great to have that in an integrated fashion. That they tell you, well, fly to Montpellier, rent a car there, and then drive to your place, something like that. Another very challenging thing we want to do is traffic simulation, which on the first glance is something more scientific. You want to find out how traffic spreads over streets. But we want to use that for really realistic travel route planning information when you have a traffic jam. I mean, the problem is currently if you have a traffic jam, then there are certain heuristics which decide either you should avoid it, go somewhere else, or just stick to it, stick to the motorway, right? And if you decide to avoid it, you know almost for sure there will be another traffic jam on the detour route. But it's not in the database, and you somehow have to estimate how bad it will be. And what we want to do here is use game theoretic approaches. We want to compute something that's called a Nash equilibrium, where we simulate what all the agents in the street system do, and say, whenever anybody can pick a better route, then he will do that. Assuming complete information, which is unrealistic, but maybe a good approximation. And then what will happen is basically that if you have a bad traffic jam on a motorway, then the traffic will spread around it. There will be several alternative routes, which all will have a mild traffic jam. Some people will stick to the motorway, where the traffic jam also gets less severe because you get away from it. So basically you have several alternative routes which are all about the same speed. That will be the Nash equilibrium in such a situation. And then the route planner can just tell you, oh, look, there are these routes. They are all probably equally good. Should I pick one for you, or do you want to pick it yourself?
Do you mean assuming that everybody has a GPS device or something in their car, so they all know about all these routes?
Yeah, so that's a modeling assumption we do here. But what the traffic scientists tell us is that even if you don't have a GPS, I mean, a big part of the travelers are experienced, right? They know there's a traffic jam there every 2 weeks, and if I take the primary detour, then there will be an even worse traffic jam, so I take a different route. And therefore, this is an approximately correct assumption.
So doesn't this model say it's just as good to freeload on everyone else's detours, stay on the original route, and it'll be as good as everything else?
I mean, statistically, that's what you should do if, in the absence of different information, right? But, I mean, this system can tell you, well, these are the reasonable detours, and then you can make heuristic decisions like, okay, which one of those are the people most likely to know? Then I pick that one, and then maybe there is the traffic jam is actually less. Things like that, right? And also it depends on your personal preferences, right? Some people say it's so frustrating to stick in a traffic jam. I'd rather make a big detour, but then I can drive, which I sometimes do. But with this traffic simulation, we at least have a chance to model this in a realistic way, in contrast to just saying, oh, we have a traffic jam here, and around it, everything is fine, right? So at least it will more often tell you stick to the motorway because there will be these secondary traffic. And that's something we want to look at, and which is computationally really challenging, because now you have time-dependent travel, you have to simulate maybe hundreds of millions of individual routes, and you also have to model this stuff, which is not our part, but actually the traffic scientists, they have data sources and models that allow them to get reasonably realistic sets of trips. And basically what you then do is you have measurements also, telling you traffic frequencies on various important streets, floating car data, etc. And then they can calibrate the parameters they use for their ride generators to get reasonably realistic traffic patterns. Yeah, I don't want to go into too much more detail, so that's maybe a good place to stop and go to discussion.
I have two questions.
Yeah, Hannah?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you.
So can you go back two slides to the paralyzation?
Yeah.
So you said you can paralyze it, but there's, I mean, in contraction hierarchies, you are changing the graph. So you need a global graph somehow. So if you parallelize it more, that's not so easy, right?
I mean, the current parallelization is shared memory, right? We have a single graph.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if you have shared memory.
This is that we are updating an independent set. So you you don't have a problem about this. And then when you go to distributed memory, there are two stages. The first stage is to say, well, let's simply replicate the graph. And as long as the graph fits in each individual node, that's fine. When you're beyond that, then you can say, oh, well, let's partition the graph into a couple of chunks and work on each chunk in parallel. And only at the borders of the chunks, you have to do some communication.
How can you just replicate the graph? I mean, then one node might make changes to the graph, which might affect local searches of another node. Isn't that so?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you have something like a communication rounds here, right? So in in the beginning of each iteration, you have a replicated version of the graph. Then you determine an independent set of nodes distributed over the distributed memory machine. Each processor does a few contractions independently and produces shortcuts, new edges. And now these new edges are communicated in a all-to-all broadcast operation or gossiping operation.
Okay.
But it's not a huge communication volume because it's just the new shortcuts. So that shouldn't be a big problem. Then you synchronize again, insert the received edges into your local copy of the graph, and then the invariant that you have a replicated graph is true again.
Okay, that requires fine-grained communication, right? That's always a problem. You don't want
not
that.
Not really. I mean, you have a single gossiping operation in each of these stages, and in this implementation, it's about, for the contraction, I think something like 50 iterations, right? So you have 50 synchronizations here. That's not a big problem.
Okay.
Maybe you want to do it over cloud that's distributed over the whole globe. It should probably be on a cluster of machines that have reasonably fast communication. And for the true distributed memory implementation, of course, you want to contract the nodes that are in your local part of the graph. And then you only have to cache some part of the graph for the local searches that's at the boundary of your piece of the graph. And that will work fine as long as the graph is still not contracted too much. Then you contracted it, say, by 90%. You have only 10% left. And then maybe it doesn't work anymore. But then the graph is so small that you can go to the replication version again. So that's, I think, the pattern you should do. Of course, that's more complicated to implement than just our shared memory implementation, but there shouldn't be a fundamental problem.
Okay, but you haven't done a distributed implementation yet. You're just thinking about it. Okay.
Yes.
Oh, I have another question, if I may.
Yes.
So you mentioned this min-max label thing for time independent. That was very central. Now, as far as I can see, this works well as long as the range is relatively small. When the range becomes huge, it doesn't work anymore, right? And this is what will happen in, you mentioned public transportation. There you will just get huge ranges. Sometimes you can get there in 2 hours, sometimes takes you 12 hours if you go overnight or something. And as soon as the ranges are big, this doesn't work anymore.
You are probably right. I mean, we did that for road networks, and it worked surprisingly well. I wouldn't have expected that. When you go to public transportation, you probably have to go for a different compromise between profile search and min-max label search. namely something like you subdivide your time into, I don't know, 24 intervals or so. And then for each of these intervals, you do a min-max. And then maybe things work better. But of course, I don't know. And I mean, Robert Geisberger is now implementing contraction hierarchies in a time-dependent way. And it's not just switch on our code and it works. You have to do a lot of stuff. And it's unclear yet whether at the end it works. My feeling is that maybe it will not work all the way through. It will not contract all the way through. But you should at least be able to get rid of peripheral pieces of your network, right? You have residential areas with just one bus, and that with 20 stops or so, that piece gets contracted away. Similar for railway network pieces that are not well connected anywhere else, they will get contracted. And then maybe you get rid of 90% of your network. Then you have something where contraction eventually doesn't work very well. Then you do a combination with goal-directed techniques, something like that. You may know more about this than you have implemented one approach. And maybe soon I will know which one.
Oh, yeah. I'm writing up the paper. Send it soon.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah.
No more questions. I'd like to thank our speaker. Thank you.